Greetings. My name is Bishop Larry H. Jordan, Sr., and welcome to Moving People in the Right Direction. And this morning, my hope is that the Lord will lead you in the right direction. My title this morning is Have Confidence in Christ. Have complete confidence in Christ. He converted me and gave me the Holy Spirit that I would have confidence in him. The Holy Spirit drives me to believe the Lord in all things. The Holy Spirit drives me to believe that all things are possible to them that believe. So I believe. And Satan, hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. And I don't say hallelujah to the devil. I say hallelujah to Jesus, because Satan can't say that. But I can say hallelujah. I haven't been kicked out of heaven. I'm going there. And I'm excited about that. And I'm excited that I know how to go there. And you know what? You might not like to say this to yourself, but I say this to myself. Father, thank you for every trial, every tribulation, every defeat, every failure that I've had, to, because I have come to know you and the power of your resurrection. And I have yielded my heart to be redeemed. So now that I know that Christ lives, I know that I will live also. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 10, and let's go to verse number 35.
Therefore, do not cast away your confidence, which has great reward.
Do not cast away your confidence, because it has a great reward. Listen to this. All born-again Christians are to be strong and never cast away their confidence. Always have confidence in Jesus Christ and the leading of the Holy Spirit, so the power of God will be your reward. God's power is my reward because I overcome things that comes my way. And I'm going to deal with my health on that. Your confidence has reward, so if you have confidence, that means you have faith to believe. If you have confidence, you have faith to believe. Now, let me say this. I'm going to deal with me, and I'm going to deal with my confidence in the Lord. I've had 4 vocal cord surgeries to remove cancerous nodules. And that first surgery was in 2006. And the last surgery was in 2022. I also had radiation treatment on my throat. So after the surgeries, they couldn't put any more LASIK surgery down my throat because they didn't want to destroy the vocal cord. So I could not talk. I want to talk. I have to preach. Thank God that I had a surgeon, one of the best in the area. But that is 5 altogether problems with my throat that needed to be corrected because of cancer. 2010, I had a heart attack. And also in 2015, I had prostate cancer. Now, God didn't put any of that on me. None of it. None of it. None of those diseases. They are diseases. And they are diseases that are in and were in my body. Therefore, I must depend on the name that is greater than name, and have confidence that every time I call on the name of Jesus, that I'm going to be okay whether I feel it or not. So when it comes to faith, I don't waste my time if I don't worry, but if I pray and seek his kingdom, he will automatically add that. I measure my faith to where it needs to be concerning spirituality. If I comprehend spiritually, then I will be strong physically. Now, I can't walk by how I feel. There are a lot of times I just feel subdued with fatigue, with weakness. And I just say, honey, I need to lay down. Side effects from medicine can be very, very dangerous. So everything that medical science says take doesn't necessarily mean you should agree with it. So I made sure that I would talk to my doctor and let him know that I am a man of faith. Everything that you subscribe for me to take doesn't mean I'm going to take it. There's nothing hidden from God in my body. Nothing. So now when I read the word of God and the word of God tells me that my faith has a reward, then I must act like my faith has a reward by serving the Lord Jesus Christ. Now let me say this. A lot of times when it comes to sickness and diseases, you feel this stuff. And at times you feel it when God is just saying, will you just give me 15 minutes of prayer? Well, I don't feel like getting out of the bed, Lord, because this is the way that I feel. Or the Lord may say, I want you to call so-and-so and so and tell them this. So I have adapted the mentality. I don't care what I'm going through, but I know the voice of God, and I know when God is speaking to me. Even though I'm a human being in a body, I know when God is speaking to me. This is why I am free, and I have liberality. And I'm going to keep it that way. So I don't cast away my reward. I make sure that I am going to do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. People can call me a fanatic. They can say what they want to say. I know one thing for sure. I'm alive and I'm well today because of that name. And because of faith in that name, I have been made whole. So my confidence is totally in the Lord. The devil always want to remind you of this and that and that and this that's wrong with your body. And you have to pull. I mean, faith is exercising how to use your lips and how to use your mind. And sometimes even in the quiet moments, it's just you there and you looking up to heaven. You say, Father, I pull that thought down in the name of Jesus. It is not going to spread from my mind to my heart, and it's not going to cause a reaction in my body. I'm pulling it down right now in the name of Jesus. I'm not going all week thinking about this when I know in you I can practice a lifestyle of sufficiency. I want to be sufficient. Now, I don't look for pity from a man. I look for two things from God: mercy and compassion. Those are the two words that I look from God in my situation: mercy, God, and your compassion. And we're going to see in Scripture how God manifests when we think at the time of difficulty, I need your mercy, God. Not my best friend, even the person that's closer to me than anybody in this world, Pastor Delphine Jordan. Father, as much love and much attention as she gives me, I have to come to you first. And I have to say, Father, hallelujah, I need your compassion. Hers is great, but God's is greater. If we would evaluate how to relate to God concerning how his word says relate, we will be free in our actions. Number one, I'm called to pastor a church. I don't care how tired I may be at times, how I may feel, I'm going to pastor this church. My leadership is going to be diligent. It keeps me alive. My work keeps me alive. My study habits keep my mind holy, strong, and powerful to preach the gospel. My heart is always in a position to acknowledge that I have the Spirit of the Lord living inside of me and don't take my actions out as regards of flesh. Spirit inside, flesh on the outside. Flesh wants to deal with the world. Spirit wants to deal with heaven. Spirit wants to deal with God. Okay, so let's look at this. I'm going to deal with health. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and listen to verses 4 and 5. This is a great scripture, and it's a scripture that should enhance your thinking when it comes, especially when Satan is trying to rob us of our time because of sickness and disease. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 4 through 5.
And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God.
Listen to this, please. Living in God's spiritual power, your faith cannot be in human wisdom. Now, I'm going to stop here for a minute because, yes, I trust in a doctor, but I trust more in the Lord. Remember, medicine is nothing but science. And it's a doctor trying to figure out how this medicine is going to work in your body that can turn you upside down. So I'm not telling anybody to try to walk in my shoes right now, but there are just certain things. My wife will tell you, a lot of times she will ask me if I would take this or I would do that, and I say no. This is where I'm at. For me to die is the gain. Now, I walk in that. Most people don't even like to talk about death. But it's a reality. For me to die is to gain. To be free of the symptoms that's in my body. As a matter of fact, let me do this real quick. Let's go to Revelation chapter 21. And let's look at verse number. Every time I read this, I remind myself of this. Every time I read it, I am just so happy and thrilled to say, wow, this is waiting for me. Lord, you're personally waiting for me to fulfill this. Revelation chapter 21. And let's look at verse number. Let's read verse 3 and 4.
And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away.
Now, who in their right mind would not want that? Now, listen, I don't desire to be separated from my wife. I always ask God, come and get us and take us to glory together. That's how much I love her and want to be with her and be around her. However, I have been attacked with a disease. So now I have to be comforted. I have to comfort myself knowing, and we say that all the time, when mom or dad is sick, they're going to a better place, and they are. They're going to a better place. But when you are attacked with sickness and disease, how do you really think about God when it comes to your departure? I can't stand this world. I don't like the Democratic Party. I don't like the Republican Party. The federal government, all of that's going to pass away. A dictator is on his way. So I stay healthy to preach the gospel and do the perfect will of God. Wise man, therefore, do not be unwise, but God wants you to be wise to do the perfect will of the Lord. So I wanted to validate that. My heart is in the security of what my future is. My future, there is no more crying. There is no more pain. There is no more death. There is no more sorrow. None. Gone. Period. End of it. Who in their right mind as a born-again Christian would not want that when God said it is your time to go? The devil can't take my life. He already tried. He put cancer in my throat. He stopped me from singing, but he didn't stop me from preaching. He took my I had my prostate removed because of cancer in there. And let me say this to every man in here. The moment your prostate is removed, you definitely have to walk in faith. You definitely have to walk in faith. It changes your entire manhood mentality. And if you don't know him in spirit and truth, and you have been feeding your wife to walk with you in spirit and in truth, and you all have been growing together to balance your life, brother, you are in trouble. It's important to know how to build relationship, husband and wife, concerning everything, in goodness and in health. Good times, bad times. How do we incorporate ourselves to know the Father in the power of his resurrection in bad times where our body is attacked? All right, so now I'm going to walk knowing what's available for me. Listen to this. Living in God's spiritual power, your faith cannot be in human wisdom or persuasive words. And I've been trying to be persuaded to go this way in my decision making and go that way in my decision making. I never forget when I was laying down going through that machine having that radiation. I told my doctor, I said, listen, that mask you put on my face, if you don't remove it, make it softer, more presentable for me to sit under this thing for 45 minutes, I'm not coming here anymore. Period. I told him that. He wasn't listening, so I didn't come back. So I get a phone call. Okay, we're going to adjust this thing. We're going to adjust it. We're going to have you in there right. Now, I'm dictating what's in my spirit for my liberality. You don't have control over me. Jesus does. And I'm saying, Father, I can't deal with this. I can't take this. This is not comfortable. My reward is, Lord, I want comfort. So now you deal with this doctor for me that he can understand I'm not coming back here because I believe you can heal me at any given time, period. So we got that resolved. And of course, I always talk to her about these things. But we got that resolved. As a matter of fact, I gave the mask to my grandson. I said, here's my mask. You play with it and do whatever you want to do. Play Monster Man or whatever. But this is what gets me. The doctor said, do you know what you're doing? I said, yes, I do. One little word, doc. This is what I want you to understand. I'm coming here to be comfortable, not to feel bad. Now, when we got that resolve, here comes the victory. I set the standard. Now, a lot of times people, I'm not saying you're not me, but this is me. I set the standard in any room that I am going to participate with a person because he whom the Son sets free is free indeed. So I'm not going to let anger, I'm not going to let jealousy, I'm not going to let competition, I'm not going to let any of those things rock my faith and move me out of the will of God, knowing that Jesus, hallelujah, is always in a place to manifest his presence in righteousness. So if we know how to talk, we know how to communicate, God is going to be there. Let me continue this. Your faith cannot be mingled. It cannot be mingled. Your faith, if you're going to believe God to keep you alive with a disease, your faith cannot be mingled with the wisdom of men, but only in the demonstration of the power of the Holy Spirit. The power of God's Spirit is always available for you. God knows your heart. The Lord warns you not to continue in sin when he heals you or a worse thing will come upon you. As a 21-year-old Christian, I had this, let me get this word. Elaine's favorite word. She used to always say, Larry got that zeal. He got a zeal. And I have zeal for Christ is the right thing to have. But the doctrine at that church was telling us not to have a zeal. So I have a zeal. I had a zeal for Christ. And when you first get saved, Elder Graves, you know that. You prayed over bubble gum, chewing gum, and everything when you first got saved. Lord, bless it. I want to be holy. I don't want nothing to come out of this bubble gum or chewing gum to mess with me at all. But we had this giant faith within us that we would pray for people. And we believed right then and there for people to be healed. I never forget this. The mailman that used to come to my home when I was young and lived with my mom, he got cancer. And when he got cancer, his sister requested that I would pray for him. So, of course, you know, some things only come out by what? Fasting and praying. So you know, we were fasting and we were praying for this guy. And I told him, I said, listen, give God the glory. Don't go back to cabarets, to drinking, and to house parties. Don't go back to that. I warned him as a 21-year-old minister. So God had me on the right path right then and there. He was moving me in the right direction even when I was 21 years old. The man didn't follow instructions and he died. I never forgot that. He died. He was healed of cancer. He had a good report. But he went right back to the very things I said, don't do. So, all right, so let's validate that with scripture. A lot of times we stay sick or we stay in situations because after God heals us, we revert right back to the same thing while we were sick and we're crying out, Lord, deliver me, Lord, heal me, heal me, heal me, heal me, heal me, Lord. And then as soon as he does it, we go right back and then a worse thing comes upon us. Let's look at scripture. Let's go to the book of John, the Gospel of John, chapter 5, and read verses 5 through 9, and then verse number 14.
Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he already had been in that condition a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up, but while I am coming, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed and walked. And that day was the Sabbath. Afterward, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, "See, you have been made well. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon you."
Now, I walk in that knowledge. I walk in that understanding. I want my spirit man to fulfill my body. Let me say that again. I want my spirit man to fulfill my body. Well, how can that happen? Well, I believe in being led by the Holy Spirit. And I believe that the Holy Spirit doesn't lead us after we come out of something to just disregard, I'm healed, I got the power of the Lord, and all of a sudden you go back. A lot of Christians do that. A lot of Christians do that. You don't discipline yourself to move forward after experiencing healing and to stay in that place that got you there. However, most Christians want to recycle Well, I can go over here and do this. I can go over here and do that. And I can be with this person and listen to this. And, you know, I can just back up a little bit. God, you understand me or whatever. And God is saying, I told you not to. That a worse thing can come upon you. I stand here to say that cancer has no dominion over me, because when I preach to you all about environment and atmosphere, an atmosphere and environment can deal with people. It can deal with the way that they think, the way that they believe, and the way that they live. So I choose, if I have to be lonely, I choose to know that I'm not lonely, because greater is he that is within me. Jesus says, lo, behold, I have overcome the world. The Lord makes it clear, joy is within me. The unique thing about this, my sister, is that we both have spouses that loves the joy of the Lord. I come home, I'm glad to see her. I only want to be apart, away from her. I'm fulfilled. The first thing that God wants in my life and to continue in my life is that Bishop Jordan, Pastor Delphine have to be strong, one unit, in how we think about my body and hers. And let me tell you about her. She speaks to me and she prays and she tells me things that she does not want about my body. And I do the same thing. Now, sometimes, you know, you don't want to hear your stomach is getting big. The waistline is getting, you know, a little bit out of place. I look at the tape sometimes. I say, oh, wow, man, Vanessa, I got a little bit of fat over here and some fat over here. Dolores is calling me the Pillsbury Doughboy. Say, I got to lose some of this. I got to lose it. The first reaction with my physical man is that I want to please her. And God want me to please her, not only with my mind and with my hugs and with my action. He want me to please her with my spirit. That's the first and foremost thing. Now I want you to see something here. Go to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 22.
The Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Grace be with you. Amen.
The Lord Jesus Christ be with who? Your spirit. Always live for the Lord Jesus Christ to be with your spirit. Isn't that what I just said? I said, by our spirit has to connect even for my healing to process and for me to be processed by the Lord. We have to be one. Keep your heart unto the Lord and have confidence in his authority. I'm glad that my wife takes authority. The scripture says that, and we read that in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Talks about how that the wife has power over the husband's body and the husband has power over the wife's body. How many of you all articulate that are married to each other? Do you get involved with each other with that, or do you just sit there and fuss and say, well, this is my body. It has nothing to do with you. Yes, it do. It has a whole lot to do with it. I got to sleep with it. I got to look at it and I got to deal with it. Vice versa. But I'm telling you the truth why I'm free, why I'm happy. I'm thankful, you know. Pastor Carter and I was talking briefly. I'm thankful for the elders and the men that I have around me. Oh, man, these guys are just great. Their faith is great. Their belief is great. Their unity is great. You can't be down and be around these brothers. We have been totally set free. These elders are so united that we enjoy being around each other. And we practice that. No illness or anything. We grow, we become stronger because we love each other. We don't devour each other. We love each other. You know what? I'm bringing the ministers the same way. We're not leaving anything out in ministry. We're going to be a church that believes in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, miracles, healing, casting out demons, spirit of discernment. I said, Father, that first has to start with my mentality, how I believe in challenges of the devil in the presence of your people. I have cancer. But cancer is not dominant because my spirit is in tune with God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I have confidence in that. No way I can be defeated if I have confidence in the name of Jesus. We read that all the time. No name, no name, no name is above the name Jesus Christ. We read that all the time. But how many times do we confess it and we believe it and we walk in it? How many times do we do that during the course of a day? Not the course of the week, the course of the day. Confidence in the name of Jesus. All right, let's go to another scripture. The Gospel of John chapter 8, verse 11. Now listen to this. Jesus healed a man that had an infirmity. I'm going back to John 5, verse 5 through 9. Jesus healed a man that had an infirmity for 38 years. This man was totally blind for 38 years. Notice it's an infirmity. God didn't do that. We're going to see how Satan puts certain diseases and certain things on people. And all God is waiting for is the honesty and the integrity of spiritual growth in somebody that is not afraid but have confidence in the Lord, that understands they are anointed with the laying on of hands to process the kingdom of heaven to somebody that has faith to believe. But often we'll back up a little bit because we don't have the sincere faith to believe. This is where we have to go. This is where we have to go. 38 years with an infirmity. 38 years with an infirmity. 38 years with an infirmity. And Jesus healed him. This man was waiting to be put in a pool. And he says, you know, somebody's always walking by and they get in there before me. Jesus said, man, we're not even going to worry about that nonsense. We're not going to worry about that. I'm Jesus. If you have confidence in my words that I'm saying to you, pick up your bed and walk. Brother, you're going to walk. Do you often tell yourself, pick your bed up and walk when you're sick? Try it sometimes. Man, I feel bad. I'm gloomy or whatever. But no, I'm getting up. I'm getting up. Sometimes I'd be so tired and so weak, I'm laying in the bed, and the Holy Spirit says, get up. And I think about it for just a few seconds, just like Jesus did in the Garden of Gethsemane. And I say, not my will, but your will be done, Lord. I want to discipline my body, and I want to keep it under and subjective to what your voice is saying to me, that I will move in the direction that you're telling me to move in. Let me get to this. Let's listen to the reading of the word.
She said, no one, Lord. And Jesus said to her, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more.
Now, this was the woman that had committed adultery. And Jesus is telling her, his compassion. Remember I was talking earlier about mercy and compassion? We're going to hit this now because these are two words that I believe in. Jesus had mercy on the blind man, but now he's having compassion on the woman who was committing adultery. And what gets me is that they never mention the filth in the unrighteousness of the man. That man was just as filthy and just as unrighteous. And that's what happens a lot of times. Poor women, poor teenage girls, poor women, they go through so much, man, when, you know, the puberty stages or whatever, and they make a mistake and they move forward. The first thing that happens is that all the emphasis is on the teenager or on the woman. What about the man? Jesus makes it clear. The scripture says you can't commit fornication and go to heaven. That's male or female. Jesus brought a balance right there. He brought a balance. And at the end of that, he told her, he says, don't commit any more sin or a worse thing will come upon you. Now we see why diseases at times stays in the body through years. And it comes alive because God says, I forgave you. I forgave you. I forgave you. And you go right back and you do the same thing over again. This is a unique thing. You could be a teenager. You could be 17, 18 years old. And you're promiscuous. Excuse me, but I have to go here. You're doing things you have no business doing. Your mother don't know it, and your father don't know it, but God knows it. He sees all things. You think you're grown. So you're running on out here, and you're doing your thing, and now all of a sudden, you contracted a disease. You think penicillin was going to take it away. And it didn't. Years go by. You get married. And then all of a sudden, your wife contracts something, a disease. All because in sin, we think often that because God totally saves us and cleanses us, that everything is your spirit that has been renewed. If you will read the scripture, the Bible talks about sinning against the body. Do we understand that? Sinning against the body. Yeah, you're holy, you're righteous. You're not doing anything out there in the street now. You're living the life. You're honoring your wife, and your wife is honoring you. But there's some. Man, I can't use those. Well, there's gonorrhea out there. There's syphilis out there. There's AIDS out there. There's herpes out there that stays in the body. But what I'm saying is true. That's why as adults now, woman, you are holy. You are unto God. Your body is pure. Don't give it to a hustler. Man, your body has been forgiven. You're pure and you're righteous. Don't go back out here and start dealing with a harlot. Don't do a worse thing. These are the kind of messages, I'm sorry, that needs to come more and more and more across the pulpit. So that we will understand we cannot willfully sin and play with sin. Understand your teenage life and don't get caught up in any adult life. Don't consistently bring the same old cycle over and over and over and over again. Don't go back. Listen to this. Praise the Lord. I like to say that. Listen to this. Go to Acts chapter 14. And we're going to listen to verses 8 through 10. Acts chapter 14, verses 8 through 10. And while we're going there, I want to say this. This is what was on my heart. Compassion means God's feelings towards you. Mercy means God's grace towards you. That's what God put on my heart. God has feelings for me. He has feelings for me. So when he see that my faith is reaching out to him, you know what those feelings do? It brings that compassion. I don't want you to go yet because there's still more ministry and leadership in you. When God see me going through some things, he says, my mercy is there for you. I know that it's a little tough and a little rough right now, but my mercy is there. Didn't I tell you that my mercy endures forever? It'll never go away. Just have faith. Confidence in me and my reward will not go anywhere.
And in Lystra, a certain man without strength in his feet was sitting, a cripple from his mother's womb who had never walked. This man heard Paul speaking. Paul, observing him intently and seeing that he had faith to be healed, said with a loud voice, stand up straight on your feet. And he leaped and walked.
He leaped and he walked. He leaped and he walked based upon what? I want to ask you a question. Based upon Paul's what? Based upon Paul's instructions. Based upon his instructions, the man was healed. Now, there are things that I will be talking about concerning instructing you how to have confidence to build your health. And if you will follow the guidelines of the scriptures, not me, but the guidelines of the scriptures, your body is going to change. I'm working on mine now. Amen. I'm Bishop Larry Jordan Sr. Bless you. We're moving people in the right direction. See you on next week.
Thank you for watching, and we appreciate your continued support. If you would like to make a donation or pay your tithes and offering, please go to tbwc.org/give. Join us every Sunday morning at 9 a.m. online or on Facebook. It is our pleasure to introduce our new online Christian education program, the Believers Bible Institute. Registration is now open for individuals interested in furthering their knowledge of the Word of God. Please visit bbitbwc.com for more information and to view our current course offerings. Jesus said, come unto me. Join us for prayer every Friday at 7 p.m. You can submit a prayer request by emailing us at prayer@tbwc.org.